amor que tanto quiero.
Yeah, I was born in Phoenix, Arizona, March the 29th, 1937. So I'm working on my 84th year. And then my parents came from Mexico right after the Mexican Revolution. And we lived in the Mexican neighborhood just south of downtown Phoenix, with all the Mexicans lived between downtown Phoenix and the river bottom. Mm-hmm. And everybody lived, there were different neighborhoods all around. There was a Golden Gate, there was a Campito, there was a Sonorita, there was all kinds of neighborhoods in the old days. And we were all concentrated on those neighborhoods. And that's where I grew up.
In your neighborhood? What was your neighborhood?
My neighborhood was called La Sonorita. Because the name of the street was Sonora. Sonora. We call it Sonorita. But there was all kinds of neighborhoods in the south side. And anyway, I went to Lowell School there, which is right about some 4th Avenue, the 1st Avenue, and right south of Buckeye Road. That's where I went to grammar school. And I graduated from there in 1952. And then I went to, they used to have what they call a Phoenix Tech. It's not there no more. And I only lasted 3 months. Dropped out. And I went to work. And I worked until I retired. Until I was 62 years old, retired.
So how about your parents? What was your mom and dad's name?
My mom's name was Paz. Her maiden name was Paz Aguilar. Paz Aguilar. My dad's name was Juan Hernandez. So I'm Hernandez. John Hernandez. And I had... all of us were, the one time there was 12 brothers and sisters, but three of them died when they were infants. And none of us grew to adulthood. And there's only three of us left right now. My sister Leonora lives in the state of Washington. She's 98 years old. And my sister Tommy, her name is Tomasa, but they call her Tommy. And she lives in Vacaville, California. She's 85 years old. And I mean, I'm going to be 84 pretty soon. Anyway,
how many brothers did you have?
I had, three brothers and five sisters.
Three brothers and five sisters?
Yeah. And they're all gone except for two sisters and myself. And I had three of them. They were in the Second World War, my three oldest brothers. And one of them, Richard, was in the Normandy invasion. He was on the, it says, he told us that, the first wave that hit the beach, they're all got slaughtered. He said, the only thing that saved me, it took 3 days to unload me from my ship. He said, there were so many ships unloading soldiers, and it took 3 days to get off. I was glad to get off, he said, from that ship, because they were like sardines. And by the time he got off, they're already taking the beach. They were already over the hump. So that saved me, he said, from getting killed right there in the open of the beach. A lot of guys died there.
Was that your oldest brother?
No, my brother Richard, the one that died 2 years ago.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. My older brother, all three of them got wounded, but they all came back. Mm. Anyway, and then they came back, got married. And then, my wife was named Antonia Sanchez. And she lived in my neighborhood. And she was a little bit older than me, a couple of years. And she was my sister Tomasa's friend. And she used to come to visit my sister, you know. And my mom used to tell my sister, hey, Tomasa, that little girl that comes over here to see you, I don't think she's going to see you. She's waiting for your brother to grow up. She's waiting for me to grow up a little bit. And she got me and got married, you know. And then we had my oldest son, his name is John Hernandez Jr. And then I have Gabriel and Daniel and my daughter Judy, my son Fred, my son Mark, and then Maria. Maria was the last one.
The baby,
yeah.
How was it growing up back in the old neighborhood, growing up in Phoenix before?
When I was growing up?
Yeah, before you met Tonya and just growing up. And
well, it was, the streets were all dirt.
Yeah.
Nothing was paved, and everybody had outhouses. In the backyard, you know, if you were going to grow up in the room, you had to go back there near the alley, you know. And they were just little shacks with little holes on top. That's it. That's where it was, you know. Mm-hmm. If you had to go to the bathroom at night, you had to walk all the way to the alley, you know. That's the way it was, you know.
Yeah. know.
And we didn't have inside plumbing inside the house. No. My dad built a little shower, made a little shack like a shower, no roof on it, put a hose on top. And that's where we took a shower. You know, it was bad in the summertime, but in the wintertime we had my mom had an old iron stove. The old time iron stove, and you had to feed it wood to heat it, you know. And in the wintertime we had to heat the water. When you had to chop the wood, turn the fire in the stove and put water on top. It was a long process. And then, you know, you get into the big tub like this, and you get another tub with clean water, get on this tub, and just, a new cup. That's the way it was, you know. And my mom used to have chickens. And my mom, anytime you wanted to eat chicken, I had to kill it. And my mom would get the water, and one time she told me to kill a chicken. I had never killed a chicken before. I was about 11 years old. How do you kill a chicken? She said, well, just grab it by the neck. And go like this. So I did. I closed my eyes. You know, okay. Until the head come off. And then the chicken started going. And then my mom grabbed it and put it in the boiling water. And then they pull it out. They just pull the feathers out of there. You know. Yeah. That's the way it was, you know, the old days. And I still remember people in my neighborhood, they had horses. There was a family, the Mexican family, they had horses. And there was an old man we used to call the Tata, the grandpa. Mm-hmm. And he had an old wagon like in the movies. And had two mules. He used to hitch up the mule to the wagon and used to go to the river bottom to chop wood to sell. And then we'd come down the street, we used to hang in the back of the wagon. It was going real slow. But that's the way it was in the old days. And you could still hit the... Part of the old West was still there, you know, by the end of it, you know.
Yeah.
Everything was changing to more modern, and there were sidewalks and stuff.
Yeah.
And anyway, that's the way it was. And people used to come down the street selling vegetables and stuff like that, you know. Payuqueros, we used to call them payuqueros.
Payuqueros.
Payuqueros, yeah. They sell all kinds of stuff. They used to come and sell you stuff at home, you know, shoes, blankets, whatever, you know. And then we got married, and then... I didn't have any money to pay for the license. He wanted a shotgun, you know. And my mother-in-law said, just say yes, young man. No, said to say, yes, I do. That's all you got to say. Okay.
So you guys used to cook outside?
No, or it was inside.
Inside?
On the iron stove. And then gradually they came up more modern, that they had those propane tanks they would put in your backyard.
Yeah.
Big old tank, and then they went, so you got a gas stove.
And you just worked around town, down in the neighborhood? Where did you guys work at? Like your dad was working?
Well, first job, I used to go out and pick cotton with they used to have trucks come by in the neighborhoods and pick up people early in the morning. And pick up cotton, onions, whatever, and you get in the truck. And go. But when there was no school, you have to do something. They put you to work with everybody.
Yeah.
And they used to get it up 4 o'clock in the morning, get up there and stand in the corner till the truck starts up and jump on it, you know. But everybody used to do it.
You know?
And we used to go pick cotton. I wasn't good at picking cotton, man. Not good at all.
How about downtown? Did you guys ever go into downtown Phoenix?
My first job downtown was I got a job at the place called the Arizona Laundry. I was about 15, 16 years old. It was right there on about 4th Street and just north of Washington. Or I think it was the next week, Adams, I think it is. I don't know. Right there, it was right there. I worked there for about a year till I got about 16. And then I got to work in the construction. I worked different jobs. I was always getting here and there, trying to get a better job, you know.
I remember you telling the stories. I've heard you talk before about you guys. You weren't able to live north of Buckeye, huh?
Oh yeah. Well, that's why everybody, all the Mexicans, you live south of Van Buren, because they wouldn't sell your property north of Van Buren if you weren't white. It then started to change till the veterans came back from the Second War.
Mm.
And they started fighting for their rights. You know, they came back. And that's when they built the American Legion Post 41. That's where they built it, right after the war. Yeah.
Yeah, just north of Buckeye.
The first, I think that was the first Hispanic American Legion, and that's where everything started to change. You know, then they paved our street. You know, they put sidewalks and all that stuff. You know, there. You know, and at first when there were those sidewalks, that a car would go by and it's dust all over the place. I mean, just a big old cloud of dust. She can't keep nothing clean. And those days, the bath time was Saturday. You didn't take a bath during the week. You didn't.
Only on Saturday.
It's on Saturday. I don't know why Saturday, but it was Saturday was bath night. You know. I mean, it was just a long process to take a bath, you know, especially in the winter time. You know, in summertime, you could jump out of the cold hose and lather up, you know. But in the wintertime, no. Anyway, I married Tonya in 1954. It was about 66 years ago. And then we had our oldest son, John. Then we had our second son, Gabriel. And our third son, Daniel. Then I had my daughter, Maria, or Sophia. No, my daughter, Judy. Then I had my son, Freddy. And then we thought that Freddy was going to be the last one. There was five of them already. And 9 years later, Fred was born. Mm-hmm. You know, the gap between Mark was born. But between Fred and Mark is 9 years. And I thought, well, maybe this is the last one. I'm getting too old for this stuff. And then 5 years later, she got pregnant with Maria.
Yeah.
And that was a total surprise, but hey, better cut that out, Tonya.
How old were you when Maria was born?
I was 40 years old.
40, yeah.
Yeah. Tonya was 2 years older than me. She was 42 when she had her.
Yeah.
Anyway, and it's funny because I think I told you this before. I was in the hospital when Tonya was having Maria. And most of the guys were about your age, you know, the younger, you know, guys in their 20s, you know. And I was there, I already had started getting gray hair, you know, and gray hair and my mustache, you know. And I was talking to this guy, it was his wife having a baby, and a young guy, you know. And the doctor came in and said, "Congratulations, young man, your wife had a baby girl, I think it was." And they said, "You too, Grandpa." No, my wife's having a baby.
They thought you were a grandfather?
Yeah, they was with a grandfather. Oh, my wife having a baby, oh, okay. But she was nothing, she weighed 13 pounds something. 12, 13 pounds, she was a big old baby. Anyway, my wife used to live, when she used to come visit my sister, I never paid attention to her, you know, I was younger, you know, and they told me I went to play with my marbles. They meant another thing, but I knew I would go play with cars, you know. And one day, I was about 16 years old, and I was trying to notice girls, you know. And she came by to see what looked to my sister, and then she walked by me and said, "Who the heck is this, man?" This is a man. And then she stayed with my sister for a while, and then she started walking. She lived about a half a block from my house. She walked down the alley, and it was kind of a little dark. And she was walking home, and I said, "I think I'll walk her home." Down the alley. And then I walked down the alley, and I grabbed her and gave her a kiss. And she said, and then she started to run. And, you know, I surprised her. And I used to tease her because she had a fence in her backyard about, I don't know how tall it was. And that you were so excited until you jump over that fence, didn't even touch it. I thought, loco.
And you guys got married when?
It was April the 12th, 1954.
How many years were you married?
We were married almost 63 years, because she passed on February, and it would have been 63 in April. So it was almost 63 years.
63 years.
And she's been gone almost four, so almost 67 years ago. Long time ago.
That's a long time.
Yeah.
To be married.
We were married for a long time. You know, I was a bad boy at first when I was first married, you know. I was doing stuff that I wasn't supposed to. But anyway, she never left me, and we stayed together. She never got separated, never. No, she never said, I'm leaving, I'm going to my mom's house, never. We stayed together. We never lived apart. And I just started to work. I didn't even have a job. But she was a very religious person. She graduated from Immaculate Heart Grammar School. Her mom wasn't religious, or her dad, and they never went to church.
Yeah.
But she wanted to, you know, as a matter of fact, she said that they didn't even encourage her to go to school, but she went to school. And when she was in the seventh grade, she said she transferred to Immaculate Heart. And she didn't even tell her parents, she just transferred. Mm-hmm. You mean you didn't tell them? Nah, they didn't care if I went to school or not. So she transferred to Immaculate Heart and graduated. She went 1 year there.
Wow.
And graduated from there at 9th Street in Washington.
Mm-hmm.
She graduated from there, yeah. And when I married her, she wanted to go to Mass all the time. And I wasn't Catholic. I was Episcopal. I was grew up in another religion. But to me, God is everywhere. You know, so I was an altar boy when I was a kid, and my dad was a lector, but it's in Spanish, you know, mm-hmm. but in the Episcopal Church. So I converted. I said, don't matter to me where I go to church, as long as I go to church, you know. Mm-hmm. I know she was never going to change, you know, the way she was, you know, stubborn like that. But I converted when I was about 19. I became Catholic.
Yeah.
I've been a Catholic ever since, you know. And that, it was a good thing, you know, because we were together. We used to go to church Mass together. We used to go almost every Sunday. We go to Mass. Never miss. I think that was kept up. That's what kept our family together.
Yeah.
You know, because she would get mad at me sometimes, but not too long, you know. Sometimes she wouldn't talk to me for a week, but she would feed me.
She'd always feed you.
And she always fed me, man. Yeah. You know, whenever it did something wrong, she would feed me. You know, but they were, you know, we get together good, you know. Otherwise, we probably wouldn't last it if we didn't. If we just, you know. But it worked out. Worked out. Yeah. We live in a. We had to rent houses at first. When we had one baby or two babies, we could afford to rent a house. But then we got more babies. We couldn't, you know, too many of them. So we went to we rented some apartment projects in the Marcos and Nisa. Mm-hmm. We lived there for a while, you know, different apartments. And we stayed there for a while, and I started working for the city. And I started making I wasn't making a lot of money with the city at that time, you know, so I was a laborer.
Yeah.
And I think I was making $1.25 an hour for the city. And they used to pay us the 5th or the 20th, two checks a month, you know, and sometimes the 20th would fall on a Monday. And that third weekend with no check, there was no food in the refrigerator. My father-in-law would lend me a little money on Friday so I could buy groceries to tide me over the weekend.
Yeah.
And Monday, when I got my check, I paid it back. But that's the way it was. You know, we used to eat commodities, too, for the kids, you know, because they gave us there's a place there on Central Avenue, just south of the tracks on Central Avenue in Buchanan, I think it was, the warehouse, where you go there and Like the St. Mary's food bag, something like that.
Yeah.
But I think it was run by the state or the county. They would give us powdered milk. They would give us cornbread and cornmeal. You know, all kinds of stuff. Flour. They would give you powdered eggs.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. You know, that we used to that you could use, you know, because I had five kids. You know, and we used to. You go there all the time. Well, I don't forget how often they would give it to you, but we used to go there and get it, you know.
Yeah.
You have to. When you have to, you have to.
Tonya never worked?
Huh?
Did Tonya ever work?
Well, so many kids, no, not yeah. then, you know.
Yeah.
But after a while, she started working here. She used to work Well, she used to work at a laundry. When I married her,
yeah,
the Phoenix Laundry, I think it was. You know, it was a hard work for them because it was real hard, real hot, and the laundries were real hot.
Yeah.
And I don't think they had refrigeration. And they used to do a lot of laundry for hotels, and they used to wash the sheets for the beds. And there was that big old presses, and a daughter, you know, and the sheets would come down on the other one side, and then the girl, two women would fit them on one side, they would come out the other side pressed. Then they would fold them, you know, hotter than heck.
Yeah.
You know, that's where she used to work. After we lived there for a few years, and then we bought our first house in South Phoenix. At 6609 South 6th Avenue, I never forgot the address. With that little tiny house, two bedroom, and with no insulation, a swamp cooler. But it was a house, you know, got out of the project. And we stayed there about 7 years, 8 years. It was in South Phoenix, between Southern and Baseline. And then...
Your brother lived right there, too. Huh?
Yeah, he was there before I was. He lived there for a long, long time. See, I think about that was when it was new. Way back in the, I don't know, the late 40s or early 50s.
Yeah.
You know, and they were both. You stay there all the time.
Yeah.
And then they started going to school in South Phoenix, and then they were having a lot of problems in South Mountain High School with the whites and the colored, and they were having a lot of problems, a lot of terrible fights over there in the streets, man. And it was kind of bad there for the kids. You know, they would take your money away. They would take your shoes off, all these things there, you know. In other words, you had to fight every day just to go to school, you know. And I said, man, I got to get out of here. I got to go to the west side. So I sold the house and moved over there to Carhartt. And the first day I went to drop the kids over in Carhartt, there was a big old fight in front of the school.
It wasn't no different, though.
But over there was the Mexicans.
Yeah.
Fighting. Yeah, it's the same old, you know. Nothing changed, you know. And they went to school there, and most of them graduated except for Fred. And that's where Mark didn't graduate, but everybody else did, you know.
You were at that house for...
We were there for 30 years in that house. I paid it off. I had it paid off, but it was underground and rough in that neighborhood. Remember I told you it was a big old shootout in the street? When we moved there, it was nice and quiet. You know, still a few people, white people live there, you know, but gradually they started getting full of Mexicans, you know. And after years, you know, I was there for 20, almost 30 years, and so we put it up for sale, and we sold it in 2 weeks.
Wow.
Then we moved to Avondale. And then we've been in Avondale 22 years now. And I got that house paid off now, so I got no house payment.
That's good.
I don't have no house payment, I don't have no car payment, so I'm good. I worked for the city for 38 years. I started in 1960. It was April the 1st, 1960. It was April Fool's Day. I remember. Yeah, they only had one yard there on, it was right there on 8th Street and in Jefferson. It was a little yard there on 8th Street, between 8th Street and 9th Street, I think it was somewhere in there. And they had a little parking lot in the back on street south of Jefferson, right next to the warehouses. They had a little parking lot. And they had everything there. They had the sanitation, they had the water department, they had everybody in that little yard, you know.
Yeah.
And mechanical maintenance was over there on 13th Street to Washington. That's where you took the equipment. And that's where I started as a laborer, making $1.25 an hour. Anyway, from there, the city started growing real fast at that time. It was going, building all over. Building very well and everything. And they started building yards all over. You know, they built in Southwest, Northwest, and South Phoenix. They built the one in South Phoenix. And it started spreading all over the place. You know. It got huge, humongous. Anyway, I worked there I started as a laborer, and then I went to, they had an equipment operator, one. It was a little higher than the laborer, and then that equipment operator, and you drive a pickup, or this is the one, you know. And then the operator two was a truck driver. So you made that, you drove a truck. an operator train, you like you could drive a garbage truck or a 10-yard dump. And I ended up, I wanted to make, I was supervisor, I wanted to make foreman, and so gradually I made foreman one. And I used to have a crew, they used to clean down the downtown area by brooms, you know, where the motor brooms could sweep. There's a lot of places they can't get in.
Yeah.
And they would sweep all that stuff, you know, by hand. And they had the tamale, they call them tamale wagons. They had a barrel in the wagon they would push. And they would put the dirt in there, the debris in there. And they used to park them down. At one time, they used to park them in all, there was all the Phoenix Theater that was on 2nd Avenue, or 3rd, 2nd Avenue, I think it was. Yeah. 3rd Avenue, this is one, two. Between the 2nd Avenue and 3rd Avenue, there was an old theater called the Phoenix Theater, but they didn't use it no more because it was real old.
Yeah.
And it had a basement. And he used to park up with tamale wagons down there. And actually, after they closed the J.C. Penney building downtown, we moved over there to park the tamale wagons over there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And gradually, I became a foreman too. I became a foreman over the street sweepers. I had five street sweepers under my command, you know, whatever you call it.
Yeah.
Five motor brooms and one dump truck where they would dump their debris in the truck.
So you work for the streets department?
Yeah, and I worked with them. This I retired from that department, became a foreman too. And we used to, at that time, they used to sweep major streets, what they call them, majors and collectors, which would be Central Avenue and Indian School and stuff like that, you know.
Yeah.
And the collector would be like Missouri, like that, you know. But we never got into the neighborhoods,
oh.
You know. And that's what we used to do. And I worked, but I had to work nights. I worked nights for about 12 years. But I got a bigger, when I went nights, I got a big raise. So I had too many mouths to feed. So I got to go nights and get more money. You know?
Mm-hmm.
I think they gave me 50 cents an hour more. Well, John was, he wouldn't die. He wouldn't take no stuff from nobody. You know? He was a that guy. So he used to lift weights, you know. He's pretty strong, you know.
Yeah.
And somebody tell him something, you know, he was always getting into fights, you know, always. And that's the way he still is, like that. But he's an old man now. He's 65 years old, so he can't fight no more.
Yeah.
But he's still got a little bit of stubborn speaking, you know. But not too much. And Gabriel, second oldest, he graduated from high school, and right after high school, he joined the Air Force. He left, he never came back.
Yeah.
Yeah, right out of high school, he took him to the airport, and he was gone. He put his 20 years in there and retired from the Air Force.
Yeah.
And then when he came out of the Air Force, he became a cop. He was a policeman over here at the Indian Reservation over here in the casinos, where the casinos are over here just west of Scottsdale.
Yeah.
He was a cop there. He worked there for about 10, 12 years. He retired from there.
He just retired,
yeah, from the police department. And he was the cop for the Indian Reservation.
So John was your oldest?
John was my oldest, and then Gabriel was the second.
And then
Daniel was the third. Daniel was easygoing.
Yeah.
He still is easy going, you know. He's to get along with, he got five grandkids now.
Yeah.
You know, he's doing good. His wife works for the post office, and he's retired too.
Yeah.
John's retired, and Gabriel's retired, and Daniel's retired. And my daughter Judy is going to retire next month. She works for the city of Phoenix.
Judy is your first girl?
My first girl, yeah. She's going to retire on November the 16th, I think, is it? The last day.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then Mark's the only one that didn't graduate from high school.
Well, after Judy, after Judy came Fred.
Right? Oh, Fred, I forgot. Yeah, Fred. But Fred's okay. Fred liked to go to school, but he had a learning disability. But he liked school, you know. And he it went on and went on until he graduated, you know. He graduated from high school.
Yeah.
And then my son Mark, which is the gap, 9 years gap between Fred and Mark, and he had a hard time in school learning stuff, you know. But he's good with doing stuff with his hands, but he knows everything about sports.
Yeah.
No, everything. You know, they can tell you this and this and the dates and the movies, old movies, but they go to school, he just can't concentrate. And finally, about 8-9 years ago, he became a born-again Christian. And he got praised all over the place now. Where he goes, he starts praying. It's like you're better this way than the other way. And Sundays, he's working, you know. He's working at the airport. So he's doing good.
And then your baby?
And then my baby girl, Maria. I went to tell about Maria. Maria was a good girl. But I remember when she was a little girl. We were at my suegra's house. We were in the backyard. And then we were at some kind of party, a birthday party for somebody. There was a bunch of little kids there. Maria was about 4 years old. And I would just sit there talking to somebody, my brother-in-law, somebody. And the little girl that I had won the crowd, I knew her, you know, was one of the families. She was combing my hair, you know. And Maria was watching, she was watching, you know. And she didn't like it. And she came over to me and went, "Pow!" It's like me. I do, you know. She slapped me and walked away. But then just some single day, she didn't like the little girl combing my hair, you know. I remember that.
Yeah.
And she's always been very, you know, trying to take care of me, you know. Don't let nobody mess with me, you know. It's not, I mean, all the way like that. Anyway, and she graduated from Carl Hayden with high honors. She was pretty smart in Carl Hayden. One of the top students, you know. And she went to ASU. She studied one of the dorms. And she said, "You know, when I went to ASU, I found out I wasn't the smartest I thought I was." She said, "No, she said, I thought I was smart in Carl Hayden, but not over here." You know, so it's like a culture shock for her.
Yeah.
You know, but she was sort of in the dorm with all kind of different people. You know, and he said, "Some of those white kids, man, they're wild, man." You know, they're going to doing drugs and going there to see the girls, and they're supposed to be in the girls' dorm, but they were in there.
Yeah.
For her, it was a culture shock. She wasn't used to that. You know, she wasn't used to having around white people. You know, so that's a learning experience, you know, for any kid, you know, like that, you know, that's never been, be raised up in a Mexican neighborhood and going to high school that's almost 99% Mexican, and then going to a place where there's a lot of white kids. It's a shock.
Yeah.
You know? Well, you find out how other people act, how they behave, you know, and it's different. More liberal, you know.
So 62 years in marriage?
Yes.
How many years working for the city?
38 years. Yeah.
Now you live out, you moved out, you moved out to Avondale.
We moved to Avondale kids, about 22 years ago.
5 kids later?
Yeah.
All the kids are grown. How many grandkids?
We have, I think, 22 grandkids. And we just had a new addition of one of my great-great-kids. I think I have 11 now.
Yeah.
Great-great-kids.
Great-great-kids.
Yeah. It's a big family.
Big family.
Yes. Yeah. The best you could do in this world is get educated. For all my grandkids that are listening, go to school. And you get as much education as you can. And it'll be a whole lot better for you. You know, that's the only way to live in this world by getting a better education and try to get as much education as you can and always take care of your kid folks, your brothers and sisters. If they need help, give them help. You know, and your parents, take care of your parents, you know, and help them out because when they get old, they're going to need some help. You know, they get old, they get feeble, like me. You know, they need help. You know, and be kind to your parents and your grandkids and your kids. Don't be treating your kids bad. You know, show them more love than anything, but show them discipline too. And love them all, and I love all of them, you know, and they, I wish I could take care of all of you, but I don't have the money. But, you know, but like I say, education is the best thing to do. And the thing, the best you can do is stay close to God. That's the thing that kept me and my wife together, you know. Stay close to your faith. And that's the only way, you know. There's no other way to travel right now because there's so much going on, you know, so much stuff, bad stuff going on, you know. That just, that's all I got to say. That I love all of you, and God bless all of you. And hopefully we'll see you when we see you up there.
We will.
Yeah?
We will.
Okay, I will, you know. I'm just glad to be going, if I want to kick the bucket, I hope I go straight to where my wife's at. I hope she's not in the wrong place, though. I'm going to go that way.
My name is John Aguilar Hernandez. I was born in Phoenix, Arizona, in March the 29th, 1937.